Roderick Hudson by Henry James. Dramatized by Lavinia Murray.
His name came to me during a reverie. Roland Mallet. I saw him draw breath as I exhaled. I knew him. I knew him to be suffused with life and desire, yet reluctant to live. An American gentleman so fearful of causing harm that he banished himself to bachelorhood and inertia. One could say that he is lost. Quite lost.
I am lost. It is comfortable being lost. Until I am reminded that my heart is empty of purpose. My soul devoid of companionship. How empty are my days. How hollow my nights.
Roland Mallet, we are no one until we have proved our worth, our value upon another soul. Until then, there is neither darkness, nor light, nor definition, nor purpose.
I have a sense of irrevocable loss.
I will give you what you need. The occupation of love, a chance to satiate desire, and to that purpose, I shall direct a young, restless, and uprooted Virginian towards your settled procrastination. A young man with an untried soul of tremendous potential. An artist. What is art but the desire to allow others to see with your eyes? To allow another soul into the understanding of your heart? It requires bravery. Let me be brave. Let me take life by the hand and brave the world. Yes, here are clapboard houses, gardens loud and bright with the bombast of late summer, as Roland Mallet, a wealthy Bostonian without a guiding interest, arrives at the Northampton home of his young, widowed relative by marriage, Cecilia. Committed bachelorhood has honed him for the solitary life. Matrimony seems such a thing full of sunlight. And Roland Mallet, as I have said, craves the shadows and their dark illumination. He hopes to turn his directionless desire into the freedom of doing some good.
Cecilia, my dear.
Roland. Oh, I was expecting you at evening. I shall say you have arrived to divide the evening from the afternoon.
Do they require division?
Everything is about beginnings and ends. You are shortly to leave for Europe.
And your veranda is the jetty from which I will depart for the old world.
Lemonade?
Thank you.
What do you mean to do in Europe?
The same as I do at home. No great harm. Perhaps I'm holding myself back for a grand coup, a lightning strike of inspiration.
You are afraid to act. I should have said, my dear Roland, that your nerves were tough. That your eggs were hard. You have an aptitude for beneficence, that's for sure.
I am unable to tell the wrong cause from the right. I'm tired of myself. My own thoughts, my own affairs, my own eternal company. And true happiness, we are told, consists in getting out of oneself. But the point is not only to get out, you must stay out. And to stay out, you must have some absorbing errand. But I just don't feel ardent and passionate about a hospital or a dormitory. You know, I sometimes think that I'm a man of genius half-finished. Genius has been left out. I fear I shall spend my life groping for the latch of a closed door.
What an immense amount of words. You want to fall in love.
Well, I'm not inflammable. Boston has failed to promote a spark. Are there any damsels here that you think might...
No. I can think of no one. I may not be able to show you a pretty young woman... But I can show you a pretty boy behind you. A bronze statuette.
Oh. Why didn't I notice this before?
Oh, you were launching clouds from your cigar like a gathering storm.
May I look at it? Who made this?
It's a little thing of Mr. Hudson's.
And who the deuce is Mr. Hudson?
You are smitten.
Can one love an object? Who did you say made this?
Mr. Hudson, a young neighbor, made it. It's called Thirst.
How old is he?
23, 24.
He's from Northampton, Massachusetts?
The family moved here from Virginia after the war.
And he's a sculptor by profession?
Roderick Hudson is a law student.
I wonder if he could be induced into doing something for me.
Oh, the this was a matter of friendship. I saw the figure, admired it, and then on my birthday, Roderick arrived in a buggy with this.
Upon my word, Cecilia, he does things handsomely.
Is it very remarkable?
Why, my dear cousin, Mr. Hudson of Virginia is extraordinary. Is he a great friend of yours?
I regard him as a child.
A clever child. I should like to see him.
He hasn't visited for a few days. I'll ask him over this evening.
We ugly mortals. What beautiful creatures we are.
Cecilia, my pleasure.
You walk too fast. You do everything too fast.
I know it. I can't be slow if I try. There's something inside that drives me. I call it a restless fiend. Oh, it's hot and dusty and my shoe pinches.
Perhaps a cup of tea will restore your equanimity.
By keeping me awake all night? It's hard enough already to go down to the office with my nerves set on edge. Your cup of tea would make me stay at home and be brutal to my mother.
Your mother's well?
She's as usual.
And Miss Garland?
She's as usual, too. Everyone, everything is as usual. The usual is all I can expect in this benighted town.
I beg to differ, Mr. Hudson. Things do happen sometimes.
For example?
For example, here is my dear cousin arrived to congratulate you on your statuette.
Is he hiding?
Roland, climb free of the hammock. Let me introduce you to Mr. Hudson.
I hadn't realized that I had already met him. His statuette is a self-portrait.
How do you do, Mr. Hudson? Your statuette seems to me to be very good. I can see from your look that you were wary that I should give an idle compliment.
You almost haven't.
Your statuette has given me extreme pleasure.
And my cousin knows what is good. He is a connoisseur.
A connoisseur? Yes. Then you're the first I've ever met. Let me see what they look like. Come further into the light. Have connoisseurs all such good heads as that, Cecilia?
I have to admit that my cousin is the only one I know.
I should like to model it. Will you sit for me, sir?
You won't be able to for a while, which is a shame. I should like a reason to keep him here.
Oh? I'm off to Europe.
To Europe? Happy man! I have a repulsive routine at the law office where I work. Honestly, I
He rattles on for an hour with unconscious boyish ease, giving his opinion on 20 topics. And I sit in silence and watch him and Cecilia. And then...
Look, Mr. Mallet, did you really mean what you said about my little statuette?
Yes. It's essentially good. That's the beauty of it.
I have a notion that you really know what you're talking about. But if you don't, well, it doesn't much matter.
My cousin asked me if you knew yourself how good it is.
Perhaps not.
Tell me, Roderick, do you mean anything by your young water drinker?
Well, he's a youth... So he's innocence, mm-hmm. He's health, strength. Oh, yes, he's curiosity. He's a good many things.
And is the cup, the thirst, also a symbol?
The cup is knowledge, pleasure, experience. Anything you could think of.
Well, he's guzzling in earnest.
Aye, poor fellow. He has the thirst. So, good night. Good night, Cecilia. Roland, it's too confusing to call you Mr. Mallet and Mrs. Mallet when you're just cousins. Good night, my little statuette. I leave you in safe and admiring hands.
That boy is an artist to his fingers' ends.
And now, three evenings of Roderick Hudson appearing on my cousin's veranda, bringing to life the light and the shadows, has stirred a passionate intensity in me. I feel a kindness for him. His zest, artistry, and youth are all indefinably attractive. A Sunday in August, Cecilia is on her way to church, and Roderick and I go for a walk.
Remember the day, and take care to rob no orchards.
I have my hat. Godspeed, Cecilia Mallet. I shall see you anon. Though not at church, I don't like the company.
We walk for half an hour, and then lie in the shade of a tree. Stretched out, he's like a beautiful, supple, bright-eyed animal.
You smoke, Roderick. Would you like a cigar?
No, thank you. They're vile things. I cannot see how decent people tolerate them.
it's beautiful here. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.